Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to our series on India's security. My name is Leela, and on behalf of Sapio Analytics, I have the rare honor and privilege of presenting to you a patriot who has devoted over 45 years of his life to actively serving his country and has also made her proud by having served as the chief chemical weapons inspector in the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, the OPCW, in the Netherlands, which was the winner of the Nobel Peace Prize in 2013. He is a civil engineer, a management and security professional with 45 years experience in the field of combat engineering, chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear and explosives, defense, CBRNE, and he also does work in the area of security and disaster management. He is presently the chief consultant with CBRNE Secure India, a forum and knowledge center. He is also a prolific writer and speaker who has participated in various international and domestic conferences on CBRN security, disaster management, and counter explosives issues, and he writes articles in journals worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Colonel G.H. Naidugade. Today's episode is about improvised explosive devices as weapons of choice for terrorism. Over to you, Colonel.
Okay, thank you, Leela. Thank you very much for your kind words. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. In episode 3 of our India's security series, I'm going to talk to you today on improvised explosive devices, which are weapons of choice for terrorism. Before we go for the actual presentation, I would like to highlight to you the objectives of this India security series. Can I have this next slide, please? Now, it's basically to bring in awareness to general public on various security challenges faced by India. The presentations are therefore designed to be very basic and simple and not much of technical details. And for those security professionals, this would probably be a refresher or a add-on knowledge. We have people coming, officers coming from the NISA. For them, probably it would be more of a refresher or an add-on knowledge. Now, when we talk of threats from non-state players, that is the terrorists, the militants, the Maoists, which is the extremists, and the insurgents. Next. Now, in today's presentation, we will try and understand what is an explosive and what are IEDs, and see what are the targets for these IED attacks, and see how the IED attacks impact the security forces and the civilian public. And we'll also go through types of IEDs based on the means of delivery of these IEDs. Then let us look at various initiation mechanisms for initiating these IEDs. Then we'll quickly run through various IED incidents in India for last 30, 40 years, the major ones. And then we'll come to that main crux, why IEDs are weapons of choice. And lastly, the counter IED operations, which are based on four pillars, that is attacking the network, preparing the force, defeating the device, and exploiting the incidents. And an additional pillar, which one could call, is leveraging technology in all counter IED operations. Next slide. Now, what's an IED or what's an IED? Now, IED is an explosive device placed or fabricated in an improvised manner. No, it's not a standard weapon. It's an improvised manner, incorporating explosive material, destructive, lethal, noxious, incendiary, pyrotechnic materials or chemicals and fragments designed to destroy, disfigure, distract and harass. Now, this is a definition given. There could be many other definitions or explanations of what is an IED. This is given by the United Nations Institute for Disarmament Research. One could also say an IED consisting of a charge, you know, in a container, an explosive charge with an initiator, you know, which initiates the explosion, and a switch and a power source. And It is designed to detonate on an intended target. So this is what is, in a very briefly, what an IED is. Next. Now, theory of explosives, then what's called theory of mixes, you know. A good mixture of explosive must contain two main substances, one which is very rich in oxygen, and the second which reacts very fast with this material and changes very speedily in its volume, and that thereby causing an explosion. So this is what is an explosive. It contains minimum two substances, one very rich in oxygen, the other reacting very fast with the other material, and grow in volumes, leaps and bounds, rapidly causing an explosion. Then we have good producers of oxygen. We have the potassium chlorate, potassium nitrate, ammonium nitrate, potassium permanganate, and sodium chloride. Now you must have seen in the list, you have the potassium nitrate and the ammonium nitrate are used as fertilizers. So it's easily available in the market. Now other component of the explosive is the good reaction with oxygen, which could be metals like aluminium, magnesium powders, mixture of carbon and sulfur, carbon and sugar, and other types of mixtures. Now, there's a difference between high explosives and low explosives. High explosives burn, and low explosives burn, and high explosives detonate. Detonate, they need a quick impulse, very short impulse, which detonates an explosive. You can easily burn high explosives. You can make your tea as a stove, put the high explosive, burn it, and you can make your tea on it. But low explosive burns. So that is the difference. There are other very different types of explosives, but suffice to say, at this stage, high explosives detonate and low explosives burn. So this is what is very briefly the theory of explosives. Next one. Now, what are the components of an IED? I've given you a brief idea. You see here, explosives, you know, is a mixture of two, this thing. This is actually AMFO. It's an ammonium nitrate with a fuel oil, 94% ammonium nitrate and about 6% of fuel oil. When fuel oil is burning, this ammonium nitrate then helps in an explosion. You have a container. You see here a pressure cooker container. You have initiating mechanism. You have a power source, and you have a initiator or a detonator, which gives a detonation wave boost to the explosive. And you have the switch, as mentioned here, which completes the circuit. So once the switch is on, the circuit is completed and an explosion takes place. This is, in a very simple term, the components of an improvised explosive device. Next, please. Now, what are the targets for IED attacks? So the first targets for IED attacks are the security forces, whether it is the military, whether it is the central armed police forces, civilian police in the state, or the private security guards, because they generally are the targets. And most of you who are not within the security forces would not know how effectively the insurgents or the terrorists use the IEDs against the security forces, whether it is in the Jammu and Kashmir, whether it is in Northeast, whether it's in the Red Corridors, that's the central part of India, where our central armed police forces are doing a fantastic job out there. So first target is the security forces. Second is the civilians, you know, populated areas, congregations, religious congregations, political rallies, or VIPs, you know, they are the targets. And normal population, innocent population, markets, shopping malls, other generally the targets for IED attacks. Then the vehicles, that is basically to disrupt transport or delivery of military, humanitarian, or civilian goods, or also to kill the occupants. These could be rail coaches. If you recollect 1993, Bombay blast, all on the trains. So either it could be trains, it could be aircraft, we'll come to that, ships, trucks, and buses. So these are vehicles. Next is the infrastructure, either directly targeted or which will have suffered collateral damage. Now it could be civilian or military buildings, transport networks like the roads, bridges, tunnels, railways, airports, there are commercial centers and industrial hubs, basically for visibility and for publicity sake. Then you have supply networks like the dams, water reservoirs, supply lines, electric power, gas, oil pipelines, and communication networks like the radio transmitters, microwave towers. There are instances where microwave towers were destroyed. The next slide. Now, how does these IETs impact? Firstly, it instills fear and insecurity in the population. You know, we have been, some of us have seen the explosions. It really scares people, panic and fear, and causes insecurity, and has a huge psychological impact. Anybody who's seen a live explosion, or even an explosion after the explosion, the scene, it would really have a psychological impact. Then it reduces security forces, freedom of movement and action, and thereby causing delays. You see the first picture here, how cautiously the security forces have to move, especially when large convoys of security forces, whether it is in Kashmir, whether it is in the Northeast, or in the Red Corridor, when they move, there is much ahead, there is what is called a road opening parties. So they are the ones who make sure that there are not any buried IEDs or any booby traps. So if at all, if something happens, only a small element of the security forces are affected, but not the larger body. So therefore, reduces the freedom of movement and action of the security forces. It undermines the ability to perform their task effectively and timely, because you are very cautious. You can't do it like in a normal time. So it inhibits the security forces, their ability to perform this task in a timely and an effective manner. And they are unable to protect the civilians, thereby people losing faith and confidence in the security forces. So there are many other impacts, but I've listed a few of them. And the most important next is undermines efforts to establish security, stability, and socio-economic development, thereby impeding commerce and businesses. Now, this is very visible if you go to the central part of India, whether it is Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Bengal, or Orissa. Hardly there is any development in those 169 odd districts, which are called the Red Corridor. Thanks to the great efforts by the central police forces, the number of districts which are now affected by the Maoists has been reduced to good about 60 odd districts. So the impact of IEDs undermines, you know, efforts to establish stability and social economic development. And it disrupts routine life and imposes unnecessary caution. If some of you recollect, there was a bomb blast in German bakery. And believe in me, for next 1 month, people were not free to go to any restaurants after that. You know, they were very scared. So there is already a caution on part of the public, and disrupts routine life. Now see here in the picture, the beautiful, you know, houseboats in Dal Lake. You have the huge station here, Churchgate or Victoria, you know, Chhatrapati Shivaji station. So many people moving, so that routine life get disturbed. And see here, a public or a political rally, even that gets disturbed. And it destroys infrastructure and developmental gains. Whatever infrastructure is made, we have seen in some of you, if you have been following the news today, there was a very huge explosion in Beirut, you know, at the port where there was about 700 odd tons of ammonium nitrate was stored, old one. And it initially caught fire and exploded. The complete infrastructure, port infrastructure there was damaged. But it was not a terrorist act. It was an accident. It was more of a disaster. Then it causes social unrest or further destabilization. You see, Northeast, there's so much of social unrest, and sometimes political and economic destabilization occurs. And it inhibits political process. We have been telling Pakistan, there is not going to be talks. You know what we say, terrorism and talks cannot go together. So any political process or a diplomatic process, even in Kashmir, we have been insisting that any talks with the separatists will only happen if there is no violence. But unfortunately, it is not happening. And it contributes to internal displacement, refugee flows, obviously, especially, you know, you must have seen in Syria, there's a fighting going on, there's a lot of bombing going on, millions of refugees trying to go to Europe. So it creates displacement and refugee flows. And it also obstructs humanitarian responses and civil society activities. These are some of the impacts of IEDs. Next slide, please. Now, what are the delivery means or what are the types of IDs? It's basically, when we say types of IDs, it's basically means of delivery of IDs. We have here the vehicle-borne IDs, now which either a stationary vehicle parked with a lot of explosive inside and either operated through a time mechanism or through a command, radio-controlled mechanism, or a suicide bomber, like what's happened in Pulwama. The CRPF convoy was moving from Jammu to Srinagar, and at Pulwama, this gentleman, the friend, the terrorist, he drove in with a vehicle from a side road, by lanes, drove along with the convoy and rammed his vehicle, and you know the consequences. We lost very valuable lives, roughly about 44 or 45 jawans we lost there. So vehicle borne, you must have even read in newspapers, Oklahoma bombing in US or the Lebanon earlier in the late 90s, the bombing is to take place through vehicle borne. You just load your vehicle with explosives. It's more of a suicide mission, That fellow doesn't survive. He also goes with the bomb. But other way of doing it is put it stationary in a very crowded place. You place a vehicle with huge explosives and try and initiate it and then cause damage. Then we have under vehicle, you must have seen a lot of movies, the bombs being placed under the car or under the bus, which are activated by electronic timers. So these are also the one means of delivery or a type of IEDs. Then you have the personal borne suicide bombers. You see here in a picture, the ISIS or even in Iraq or even the Al-Qaeda's, they're even training children to be suicide bombers. And a famous case of Rajiv Gandhi, our beloved prime minister, was killed way back in 1991, in Tamil Nadu by a suicide bomber. So other means of delivery is a personal bomb. Other is aerially delivered, either through UAVs, rockets, aircraft, balloons. Now you see the picture here, Twin Towers, World Trade Center. Two aircraft came one after the other, fully loaded with aviation turbine fuel, and crashed into the building, caused a huge fire. And being a steel structure, it gave in, and they lost roughly about 4,000 innocent people out there. And in my next slide, I'm going to talk about another incident where the aerial means of delivery of IED was used. Then we have the waterborne, waterborne or water use, either in the boats or floating, like what the LTTE used in Sri Lanka. You see the picture of LTTE using water. And you can also have underwater mines, improvised mines placed to disturb and to cause damage to the ships and boats or the security forces or even the civilians. Then animal borne, is something new which has come. See, Afghanistan, Iraq, the donkeys, dogs and cows were used. They were strapped with explosive, as you can see here, and sent towards the security forces. And they were all timed or even remotely controlled. And a lot of damage used to be caused, especially in Iraq and Afghanistan. We didn't have any such cases in India. Then what we call the placement, you just place an IED either in a house or on roads, under a culvert, like what's happening in the Red Corridor, under the bridges, buildings, parks, public places, trains, aircraft. They are called placed IEDs. They are placed there, either operated with a timer or operated through a remote controlled radio device. Then we also seen surgically implanted in dead bodies. It so happened in Dantewada there in Chhattisgarh, where a poor CRPF jawan was killed, was used, he was cut, his stomach was cut, the IED was placed and stitched back, and his clothes put on, And then when security forces come to, rescue him or evacuate him, and they became targets. So this is another means of delivery of IEDs. Then we have the famous robots, you can use robots. It's the safest way. And you can control the robots. UAVs could be called robots, actually. They're all controlled. So these are some of the means. There may be many, actually. especially the LTTE was very innovative. They are very, very smart in bringing out various means of delivery of IEDs, and they were so successful. And Indian Army learned a great lesson from its deployment in Sri Lanka in the late 80s. Next slide. Now, what are the types of trigger mechanisms? Now, one is the victim operated, what we call the booby trapped. You know, there are various mechanisms, spring loaded, you know, it is loaded to spring and it releases. Or it is either a push, pull or a tilt switch method. Is a trip wire, you know, innocently somebody is wiring, trips a wire and it activates. Or it's a pressure plate or a infrared motion or light sensors. These are all what is called victim operated mechanisms. Another is a command operated, either command wire operated or command remotely operated through a radio or infrared control. Then we also have time operated, you know, like you see here, the thing is burning safety fuse here. The time operated is a burning one. The chemical, you know, chemical reacts and then snaps the wire and then the circuit is complete and the IED goes. You use a mechanical means or an analog means of alarm clocks, time fuses, then we have electronic and digital watches. And we also use ICs, integrated circuits, for, you know, as trigger mechanisms in IEDs. These are broadly the three types of trigger mechanisms. There is always ingenuity on part of the hostile elements. They always come out with new ideas. Next slide. Well, just it has been depicted in a very schematic way. So firstly, based on mechanisms, it's based on delivery and based on warhead, what it contains. Does it contain purely an explosive? Or does it contain a chemical warfare agent with explosive or a biological agent or a radiological agent or maybe an improvised nuclear device? So these are various mechanisms, IEDs based on mechanism, delivery and the warhead. Next. Now the vehicle-borne IED, and took the opportunity of trying to explain you in details, is you can see here, either you can place the large quantity of explosives either under the rear seat or under the boot. Okay, the large quantity could be put. The small quantity in front of the driver where he operates, you know. And then they are either triggered by somebody opening the door or racing their car on an accelerator. That's what perhaps what's happened in Pulwama. That guy was racing along with the CRPF convoy and hit them. And probably that must have actuated. Then switching ignition, once you place a bomb and somebody innocently comes and switches on or off the ignition, it goes away. And of course, wire timers for parked cars, which are parked. And what the cops or the security forces do to identify and stop the vehicle-borne IEDs is you must be seeing, you know, is a common thing, screening of vehicles at important installation. Then there's something called slow vehicle access and choke points. You must have seen those blocks kept on the road so that you are not able to go straight away. You have to take a detour and go. So such mechanisms are there to run this thing. And this is the most sought after and it's the most lethal. A lot of terrorists prefer this and it's lethal and it also exhausts first resources of the first responders. This is such a huge bomb. So immediately, if it's a small incident, then it doesn't take away so many resources of the first responders. But a thing like vehicle-borne IEDs, it takes away a lot of resources. Next slide, please. Now you see the IED design matrix. A huge number of combinations possible. Now you have the timing, whether you know time set, whether the type of target, whether you are placing you know vehicle-borne or whatever is the placement. Then explosives, whether it is type of explosive and the quantity of explosive, the detonation method, electrical detonation or the other means of detonation, then the mechanisms and the power sources. Now you have the variables, E, all these listed out here. And these are the number of combinations one could design an IED. So this is an IED design matrix. I hope I've been able to explain that. Yeah, next one. Now, IED incidents in India last year, this has been taken out from the National Bomb Data Center with the National Security Guard. Now see here, last year you see a lot of activity in Jammu and Kashmir. You have lot of activity in the so-called Red Corridor, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, Jharkhand, and Bengal, and some activity in Maharashtra, especially the Gadchiroli district. You know that Naxalite or a Maoist district. So it's a thing, and not much on the northeast, excepting in Manipur. So these are some of the incidents which occurred, either IED blast or IEDs recovered, you know, by the security forces, or explosive ordnance blast. It didn't have been IED, it in an explosive ordnance, you know, like a normal artillery shell or something blowing up. So this is the other one, is what has been recovered. The next slide. Okay, quickly going through, if you all remember, some of you young like Leela and Sancheta, they would know. June 19, 1985, very black day for India. The Air India Kanishka aircraft, which was coming from Canada to India, was bombed mid-air. So the bomb was placed in the aircraft and blew up somewhere on the west coast of Ireland, and killing 329 people. You know, that was a very tragic thing. The second thing, of course, killing of Rajiv Gandhi by the suicide bomber at Sri Perambudur. 17 deaths, not many deaths, but it's important because it killed or a national leader. Then the famous 1993 Mumbai blast, you know, 12 serial bombings, 257 deaths. Then another important is the Samjhota Express, the train which runs from India to Pakistan from Delhi. Somewhere in Haryana, this train was bombed, you know, and 70 deaths occurred. Then the last year, February 29, unfortunate incident at Pulwama, where our brave CRPF jawans were killed, 48 of them, for no fault of theirs, by that the so-called terrorist who drove a vehicle and rammed into them. And there was similar incident in Dantewada way back in 2010. At that time, the Central Armed Police Forces were not that well trained, but now I must say they are very well trained now. It was initial phases of the deployment. So they did meet a lot of casualties at that time. And this Pune German bakery incident, you all know. So these are some of those major incidents which I've listed. There are many, but I think that suffices to give this information. The next slide, please. I just listed out again from the you know, National Bomb Data Center. So these are the incidents, number of incidents listed out here. These are the number of people killed in red and injured, you know. Now, this is only figures which are actually the attacks which occurred. But 90% of times, the IED attack attempts are thwarted by the security forces, prevented by security forces with actionable intelligence available. So general public really wouldn't know the great job done being done by the security forces. And suddenly you find a bomb explosion, and people start cursing the security forces, key lack of intelligence, they are not doing their job. But without realizing the fact, 90% of the IED attacks are prevented by timely action and based on actionable intelligence by the security forces. So you see the number of people, and these are all reported. There could be many unreported incidents. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, why IEDs weapons of choice? Firstly, they are easy to assemble. It's simple. I've explained you the mechanism, the layout, the components. Very simple. The cost doesn't cost much. And I was showing you when I was showing you the explosives. There's what's called homemade explosives. You use ammonium nitrate with something else, and you can prepare explosives at home. So minimal cost. They're very efficient, reasonably efficient. They're not very crude, but they're efficient. And they're very simple to make. So that is the easy thing. The first principle or first reason why weapons are choice of, you know, for the terrorism. Then easy availability of explosive chemical precursors, you know, like chemicals. I did mention to you the fertilizers available. And especially if you go to the Red Corridor, Orissa, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, where there's a lot of mining taking place. All these mining companies are, I would say, blackmailed or threatened by the Maoists to, you know, part with part of their explosives and show it as expended, and they use it for nefarious activities. So the explosives are easily available. Then there's a lot of information on the internet. You don't need to have no rocket science. Well, so there's a lot of information on the internet how to make a bomb. Then the IED has got a great impact, visibility and the damage. Firstly, it causes huge damage and great visibility. You see the pictures here. You must have seen today's picture of the blast which took place in Beirut. It's got a great visibility and a great impact. The massive damage has been caused. Then it affects on the morale of the security forces. Obviously, you're unable to function. You've got casualties. Imagine 44 innocent lives of the CRPF lost in Pulwama. Obviously, it demoralizes the security forces. And it affects the psyche of the civilian population. You know, they are very hesitant. They're scared. And larger the yields, so more yield, you have more number of casualties. So it is proportionate to the number of casualties is proportionate to the quantity of explosive used and the yield. Then it, any explosion, these newspaper media guys run to it, they add some masala and then put out stories. So media and public attention, that is a major factor. And that's what the insurgents or the terrorists want. They want attention, public attention to their cause. They want people to know why are they fighting for. So media and public attention. Increasing lethality and effortless concealment. So like I did mention to you, lethality is increased because of yields, then concealed, very easily concealed. It's, you know, it's like people moving what happened in Bombay in 2007, the pressure cookers. Nobody would suspect anybody carrying a pressure cooker, you know. So it's very easy to conceal. Then accurate targeting. You want to, you know, target a particular thing, you can accurately demolish or damage the target. And that is one of the reasons why it's a weapon of choice. And the bomber is safe. Most cases, that fellow is sitting pretty cool and initiating a bomb and people are dying everywhere and this guy is safe and he runs home. So bomber is safe. These are some of the reasons why weapons of the IEDs are a weapon of choice for the insurgents, the terrorists, the Maoists and the militants and the separatists in some cases. You can see the pictures. You see this famous film. It's called Train of Terror. And that's what happened in year 2000, I think 6 or 7 in Mumbai. Serial bombings in various trains. Killed a whole lot of people. So, obviously, see the images, the damage here. Yeah, next slide, please. Now we're coming to counter IED operation. Now we have seen what are IEDs, various methods of delivery, and then what are the operations which counter the IEDs, you know. And it's basically taken up by the security forces. What you see a terrorist attack or a terror bomb here and there in the cities is generally done by the bomb disposal units of the civil police. But when I talk of counter IED operation, large scale operations, what happens in say, for example, Afghanistan or Iraq by the United the Allied Forces, or even in JNK, Northeast, the security forces, Red Corridor. So they have to have a proper IED operations, counter IED operations. And the four pillars for counter IED operations, the most important is prepare the force. You must have your people ready, trained. Second is attack the networks. You know, all hostile networks who think of doing damage, you try and nip them in the bud, attack them before they attack you. You know, that is the principle. Then once you know where the device is, try and defeat the device, try and prevent it firstly, otherwise neutralize it and try and protect the population. So defeat the device. And another very important aspect of the fourth pillar is exploit the incident. Now what generally happens is once the incident takes place, you can't pack up your things and go. There's a lot of information one could get from each incident, which adds on information, intelligence. It identifies the network, which identifies the type of mechanisms, type of explosives, what are the intentions of, what are the targets, intended targets. So one must exploit the incident. So these are the four pillars of counter IED operations. Counter IED operations generally undertaken by the security forces. Next slide, please. Same thing explained here. See, attack the networks has been going on for 1 year. It's not a today's job or yesterday's job. It's a long process attacking the network. We know what are the terrorist networks in India, in Kashmir. We know how they operate, where they are, where their sources are. You see here, the financiers, the suppliers, the transporter, the builder, the planner, the emplacer, the trigger man. This is all what is called attacking the network. Then when it comes to defeating the device, you try and detect the device, neutralize the device, and protect the population. And then post-event management, that is what is exploiting. You know, you gather a lot of intelligence, then carry out an analysis, and then identify the so-called network. Yeah, next slide. Now, I'm covering little in detail. Firstly, attack the networks involves identify the threat network that employ and facilitate the IEDs. So it's understood. You try identify those networks which employ or facilitate IEDs and do detection and predictive analysis of the threat networks and their functions. It's very important. We know, say, for example, LET and say there, how it operates. So we could predict, say, every event in Kashmir, probably. We could predict, carry out a predictive analysis through analysis of intelligence, network activities of that particular hostile networks, exploitation, you know, using the population, local population, and the signatures left behind by these networks from earlier incidents. Then offensive operations against complex networks of financiers, ID makers, trainers, and their supporting infrastructure by what? Providing intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, information operations, counter bombarding, targeting, and biometrics. And what's more important is what's called the weapon technical intelligence. This is very important. They know the technical details of each type of weapon or IED which is used by the terrorist. And then consistent operational framework is always built on three tactical areas. Gain valuable information. These are very basics. Build relationship with other security forces, the government agencies, local population. That is very important. And then finally, neutralize the advisory. So this comes under the attacking the network. Next slide. Preparing the force. Yeah, you see the picture of how you need to train them. Facilitate individual training, collective training, unit training. The individual is being trained. Collective training here, collective training here. And even the sniper dogs and their handlers need to be trained. And enable the development and propagation of new tactics, techniques, and procedures. Always, you must develop and propagate new tactics, techniques, and procedures of how to do counter IED operation. The hostile networks have their own TTPs, how they deploy their IEDs, and we have to have our own tactics, techniques, and procedures. So we must enable the development. Then provide avenues for training, you know, support areas, ranges, IED ranges, where people can practice and experiment on testing of, you know, very emerging counter IED equipment and concepts. Then train how to identify, map, and target insurgent and terrorist networks, a very important aspect. You must train how to identify, map, and target the insurgents. Then positively influencing friendly and neutral populations and networks for intelligence gathering. See, we can't get, you know, bully the local population and try and get information. You can't do interrogation. You'll have to be friendly and somehow get some information. This is an essential part. You should learn how to deal with the local population. And then very wide range of live watch. Guy is doing here. Then training videos and simulation systems and the training of dogs and handlers. The next one. Defeat the device, that is predict where and how enemy employs. So you have to predict. Then prevent, deny the enemy the ability to actuate IEDs. Then detect, neutralize, then mitigate. In case it's unavoidable, then try and reduce the effects of minimizing the effects of the blast on personal equipment and facilities by pre-detonation and standoff. Okay, next. Last one. Next slide. Yeah, the last pillar I was mentioning to you, exploitation of incident. This is generally a neglected component of IED operations. Once you have carried out your operations, people just close their shop and go. That shouldn't be the attitude. This should be the one. You should exploit. So blows, you know, post-blast site forensics and biometrics provide valuable information on the techniques tactics and procedures adopted by the enemy, the designs of the IEDs, their trends and patterns. Okay, then information and hostile networks. Then it also help in favorable public, managing public opinion. You know, that's you have to carry out, try and manage as a exploitation, this thing, the public opinions. Then something information on the targets. And then we have the geospatial information systems of tracking the hostile networks, the insurgents, you know, GPS systems and other systems, technical and tactical exploitation and evidence collection prosecution is very important. You can't just leave without collecting evidence in a proper way and follow it up with prosecution. You see, we have the National Bomb Data Center with the NSG at Delhi. They are the ones who have the bomb data center. And you see, this is United States, you know, what do you call FBI, the warehouse where the information from the previous incidents is stored, the massive way. And this is how the evidence is being protected. So this is a very important aspect. Next slide. Yeah, the same thing I tried to explain in a simpler form earlier slide. This is more complicated. And suffice to say, this is a very important aspect or an important pillar of counter IED operation, which most counter IED operatives are not willing to accept or not bothered about. I being experienced in this field, I propagate wherever I speak. Please, this is a very important tool. Next slide. Yeah. Leveraging technology in counter IED operation. This is a force multiplier. You have the aerial vehicles, we have the remotely operated vehicles, we have the robots, we have the disruptors. We have what is called the non-destructive evaluation. You see here, you can evaluate an IED or a device without even to handle it. Then you have the detonation chambers in case you find an undetonated this thing. You carry it in a vehicle which has got a detonation chambers and take it to a safe place. Then we have the jammers for radio controlled IEDs, GPR, ground penetration radars, other radars, forensics, biometrics, chemical spectroscopy. You know, this is very important to identify various type of chemicals. Then it is intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance sensors, infrared imaging, and then the LIDAR. These are some of the technological things which I have listed. They are huge. If you go to the Western countries, how the Americans are operating in Syria, Iraq, and also in Afghanistan, is an eye-opener. We are not very far behind, but due to resources, we can't afford all those. But we are advancing, we are equipping ourselves with the latest technology. Next slide. Now, this brings me to end of my presentation and hope to see you all on 20th of August on a new episode number 4 on border and coastal security for a new architecture. There's a need for a new architecture. So this is what I'm going to talk to you. Now, I would like to thank you all for your patience and a very nice assembly of people, very keen. And I'm personally grateful to the commandant of the National Industrial Security Academy, Mrs. Anjana Sinha, for making sure a whole lot of our CASF officers are attending this. I'm personally grateful to her. And I thank her and thank the officers from the CASF for attending and patiently. And also thank all of you. And I'm ready for taking questions, if any.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you have seen, the Colonel has an amazing grasp of his subject. And for those of you that would like some access to the complete PowerPoint presentation, please get in touch with Hardik or Sanchita at Sapio Analytics. Colonel, this gives us a deeper appreciation for the work done by our armed forces. I feel really grateful, and I want to salute all of those that are present here today on behalf of the armed forces. There are some questions here. I'm going to start with the first one. Colonel, would you please enlighten us on your long and illustrious journey in the armed forces?
Lila, I would come to that later, but can you ask the any of the audience, have they got any impromptu questions related to the subject? I'll surely come to that question. Please.
Yes,
let's start from that.
Let me ask you one by Surya.
Okay.
Does the Indian security force and local government authorities, are they prepared for any kind of CBRN threats?
In my last fortnight back, when I covered the CBRN threats, I did mention, yes, we are prepared, but we need to do much more. Basically, there is no awareness in the public about the threats. That's very important. Not only in the public, it's also at the government level. Not everybody in the government believes that there are such threats. But certainly, we have, especially the armed forces, and we have the NDRF, some of the battalions of the NDRF as the task, you know, the teams which are trained on CBRN disasters. And even at the state level, some of the state disaster response forces are capable of doing it. But there's much more to do. A huge country like India, only 12 battalions of NDRF. And then army is busy with its own things. I would say we are ready to face, but we need to do much more. Thank you. Yeah.
Right. The next question, also from Surya, is what guidelines do we follow? Like the NATO CBR, any guidelines for civilian accidents? What are the ones we follow?
See, we have our own guidelines issued by the National Disaster Management Authority. Very exhaustive, beautiful guidelines to guide not only the first responders, to guide the states. And that is why we have it, even the district level national disaster, it's a district level disaster cells or authorities. So the guidelines we follow is purely issued by the National Disasters Management Authority, which was created under the National Disaster Management Act. It's an act of the parliament, so it's binding on all of us. We certainly can take ideas from other countries. There are some of them may be advanced, but we strictly follow the guidelines issued by the NDMA.
Sir, another question we have here is, are IEDs also being used by our military and the border forces to protect the borders?
No, we don't use IEDs. We use regular, explosive devices. We have enough of explosive devices. We don't need to resort to this thing. We do certainly use booby traps. We do use booby traps, but even those are not improvised. So improvisation only comes when we don't have the standard equipment. We are well, we have a whole lot of equipment to deal with. We have been setting up booby traps on the border, especially to reduce the infiltration in Kashmir. Security force, I'm sure also in the Red Corridor, these CAPFs also must be using booby traps to, you know, channelize the insurgents or the extremists to certain areas. We don't really need to use them, but there could be some places where, if you don't have standard mechanisms, there is no harm in using IEDs. But it is a regular explosive. We don't, they're not homemade explosives in our case. A normal switches which are available by the ordnance. So we don't need those. Yeah. Next.
So another question here is, we are very keen to understand what you and your organization have done that helped you win the Nobel Peace Prize in 2013.
Okay, good question. See, the Chemical Weapons Convention was signed and ratified by 193 countries. And they are obligated under the convention to destroy all the chemical weapons they hold. And I am happy to inform you, as of today, 99% of the stockpile of chemical weapons around the globe have been destroyed. Okay, and being a chief weapons inspector, I used to lead missions, verification missions, to verify the declarations made by the member states and also continuously monitor their destruction. So since there's a great first international disarmament treaty, which has been very successful in fulfilling its objectives and aims, I think the Nobel committee thought it fit to award our organization with the Nobel Peace Prize 2013. And some of us who are actively involved in this demilitarization were also given recognition in a sort of parchments given to us.
That's brilliant. It makes us truly proud. And sir, coming back to the question you said you would answer later, which is, would you please enlighten us on your long and illustrious journey in the armed forces?
Okay, very briefly, actually, it's my profile. Anyway, since some of your friends are very keen, basically, after doing my civil engineering, I joined the Indian Military Academy and commissioned in 1974. Actually, I'm commissioned in 1975, but we have an antedate seniority. and then did my service in combat engineering. Combat engineering deals with everything on the combat, you know, tactical bridges, demolitions, and all. And then I was also specialized in CBRN. In those days, it used to be called nuclear biological chemical. And I also did a specialized course in bomb disposal, or what we call explosive ordnance disposal. And did my what he called Defense Services Staff College, and graduated from the Army War College, and held various appointments both in staff, instructional, and command, and was a joint director in the Ministry of Defense, looking after CBR and defense for the, all the three services. So that is briefly my service. And then for about 8 years, I moved out on deputation to this organization in the Netherlands on chemical weapons, and that is where I've led verification missions around the globe, leading teams of professionals to various chemical weapons sites, and firstly verifying their declarations, and then taking stock of them and continuously monitoring their destruction. That's briefly my...
Thank you ever so much, sir. And there's another question here from Durgesh. What inspection measures are being currently employed regarding identifying and assessing suspicious objects or activity related to IED attacks?
See, you can't start doing any inspection activity out of the cuff. You know, we have laid down standard operating procedure, whether it is at state bomb disposal units, okay, or the Central Armed Police Forces. They have their own SOPs of handling IEDs wherever it's issued by the Minister of Home Affairs. The armed forces have their own SOPs. Still have to be following those SOPs for identification. And like I everything depends on availability of actionable intelligence. Just not intelligence. It should be an intelligence which one act. That should be very sure. So there is no inspection as such. You probably asked me on you know, what are the you know, procedures of, you know, defeating a device. You know, how to do it, various means of neutralizing device, the variants. Okay, I don't think we should get into that, but suffice to say, each of these forces, security forces, state police forces, bomb disposal units, they have their own standard operating procedures, and they follow them, and they keep revising. It's not that it is sacrosanct. What is today cannot be revised for tomorrow. As the situation changes, as the threat increases, the threat and changes, obviously, our procedures change. I hope it answers broadly his question.
I'm sure it does, sir. And I've got another question. How can common civilians be educated about IEDs and detecting and reporting them?
Can you come again?
Sorry. How can common civilians be educated about IEDs and detecting and reporting them?
See, basically, in fact, we have the civil defense, you know, they're the ones who should be training our civilian population. You can't expect the very meager resources available with the bomb disposal units of the state police forces or the PAFs. But we do run courses for the civil defense people in College of Military Engineering. We do run courses for identification and what do you call the preliminary actions or actions to be taken by civilian population if they have a suspect something. But being India, being a huge population and a huge city like Mumbai, is very difficult. But only it can be done what is called a public outreach program through the issue of pamphlets, posters, could be placed at various schools, colleges, universities, and workplaces. Other than physically reaching out to sensitize the population is a very Herculean task. So that's not possible with the resources available. Certain civilian organizations like the Civil Defense is getting trained. And I'm sure some of the home guards with the state police are also being trained on this this thing. And obviously, each of the central police forces have their own institutes to train. And I'm sure wherever they are operating as part of a public outreach program, they must be reaching out to the civilian population and cautioning them and warning them and guiding them on what to look for and what not to do.
Thank you, sir. And we've also got a Thavale sir over here.
Yeah.
Requested, can he share an experience on IEDs with your permission?
Please, Ram, please go ahead. Thank you for joining.
Thank you, sir, and very good evening to you all. A very insightful session, sir, by Colonel Naidu. He's like my guru, actually. I'll just share something to highlight a point which he had made during the presentation about disrupting normal life and engaging the security forces. When I was deployed in Manipur, we used to have this problem of IEDs very often. And we had a particular instance, which is still sticking to my mind, is we used to have the weekly convoy running on the National Highway 39. And that was a major event every week because it used to bring in and take away the lot of people and families and stores and so on and so forth. So it was a very important operation of, you know, conducting that convoy on that road. And one fine morning when the convoy was coming on that road, we found small bundles of Hessian cloth, each having two batteries, torch batteries, and a couple of wires taped to that and sticking out. And these we found at regular intervals around the road. Although the road opening party had gone over the road and, you know, checked the whole thing and all that, and the regular movement of vehicles had been allowed after that. And then when the main military convoy was coming, the weekly convoy, they found these things, the leading vehicles, they found these things. And the whole process of that convoy got stalled for the whole day. And we had to put the convoy into other unit areas. They could not move to Imphal the way they were supposed to move. And everything got disrupted for almost about 48 hours because then the next slot for moving the convoy had to be another day or 2 days later. And later on we found, when we opened these, Hessian cloth bundles, we found that they were dummies. And the amount of disruption that these dummies had caused, just because we thought that they are IDs, not only engaged the security forces for 48 hours in trying to check and, you know, find out how it has happened and all that, but it also disrupted normal life all along the road. It also disrupted the convoy movement. And a whole lot of stores and medical facilities which are supposed to be coming in the convoy got stalled for a long time. So that is also one of the issues, you know, a hoax call by such kind of IED looking stuff can also make a lot of impact. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ram. Thank you very much.
Colonel, we also have Lieutenant Colonel Sunil Narula here who would also like to share an experience if you're okay with it.
Yeah, please.
Colonel Narula, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Naidu sir. It was like a revision course. It was awesome.
Thank you.
So I'm happy to, you know, narrate because Ram excited me. As all of you know, most of people in SEPI umbrella know, I'm a war wounded soldier. I'm an infantry officer and have been in ops about 16 years of my career out of 23. So, had many experiences, but the most interesting experiences where I myself got shot was with LTT when I was in Sri Lanka for 2 years, which is where I got my wound medal award. So the episode was so interesting that we went to destroy the mine factory of LTT inside the jungles. It is called the Kanjarakuda jungles, one of the most thickest jungles in south of Sri Lanka, from where the border area of the Sinhalas start. So Tamil Sinhalas are two ethnic groups in Sri Lanka, as everybody knows. And LTT was fighting for an independent Tamil land. And we landed up in Sri Lanka as Indian peacekeeping force. So cutting the political narrative small, let's come to the operational part. So after destroying their mine factory, staying inside the jungle without LTT knowing that we have actually stayed back, they thought that we came, we did an operation, went back. So we played in their trick and we shot Newton. Newton was the main engineer of LTT, used to improvise the IED. And let me tell you, their factory when we destroyed, I have many mementos in my battalion. They were all Japanese batteries and Japanese things, which they used to bring from PLA. Most of the training of LTT was done by PLA, that is Palestinians, and they were very good in IED. Let me tell you, out of my experience with all types of insurgency and militancy and terrorism of Punjab, I found them the best, and I salute LTT for that. They would create a hybrid version of IED. So Naidu sir, when somebody asked him this question, so he was telling you there is an ordinance issue also, like which we use, somebody asked. So we call it the claymore mine. Now what claymore mine is, you know, it is in the shape of a, like a, how do you describe, Ram sir, claymore mine shape? Like a plate, like an inward looking sheet.
It's a concave plate. Which has explosive and shrapnel built into that.
Yeah. So there, you know, like the main explosive is a plastic explosive on top of which the shrapnels are fitted. Mostly they used to use the ball bearings of the bicycle, which then becomes small bullets. And when you blast it, and then area of danger area of almost, 25 feet, anybody who's there will get very severely injured with pellets all around. It's one of my Subedar Major who actually got that injury. He's alive. He takes care of the Jammu airport in CISF. CISF people are here. And his whole backside still has about 140 pellets inside his body. We could not remove many of them. And then his body got attuned and wherever in the muscles they are stuck. Like in my case, when I got shot by the G3 bullet, the bullet went through and through from my shoulder in the same IED attack. So they had planted an IED facing a jungle track. And they had put the anti-personnel mines with which we used to lose our lower part of the leg. So many of you have seen military people with, legs, half the leg gone, is with that improvised device they used to make as anti-personnel mine, which Naidu sir and his team and so many other engineer officers of Indian Army have participated all over the world to clean up these minefields. And we used to do it in J&K also next to the LOC. So that IED didn't blast, fortunately for me. And my whole half of my body was actually facing that IED, and my Hawaldar was behind it. He touched the wire of that LED because he took position behind the tree when they opened fire on us. And I had only one chap with me who was carrying a rocket launcher. And in the rocket launcher, we have an anti-personnel Airbus model. So the nearest you can blow that thing is at 100 meters. So that's the lowest. So by the time my chap set it up, the firing happened and my shoulder, I got shot in the shoulder. But that IED didn't go. And you won't believe, at a time of operation in the war, it is very difficult to say that there is an IED. So the Hawaldar who was behind me, who later became a Subedar Major, I still remember his name, Ram Lal, he said he lost his speech times. And he said, sir, Sabji, atom bomb. Because he could not describe it as an IED. He saw it right on top of it and I was standing in front of him. Later, of course, I backed him up, you bloody fool, you should have pushed me. But anyway, by the time the blood started coming out. So why I'm sharing this live experience is that LTT used it in a very comprehensive manner. They laid the IED, they were sitting there with their ambush, they had the anti.
We lost your audio. Sunil.
Dave? Yes, sir. You lost my audio?
Colonel, if you could just speak up, we can't hear you clearly.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Now, yeah, you need to speak loudly, Sunil.
Ah, okay, sorry. So because we had, now it's better, sir?
Yeah. A little, yes.
Yeah, sorry. I'm so sorry. I just forgot. Actually, I'm outdoor and I was using a Bluetooth. So,
okay.
Though we shot Newton, and Newton had his bike in his factory, deep inside the jungle. And they had an obstacle training course for the LTT cadres inside the jungles, which we booby-trapped. Colonel Naidu was telling you about booby-traps. We are also good at, setting up booby-traps. I had an engineer platoon with me from here, whichever regiment, I think 7 engineer. I forgot the name of the engineer. Otherwise, Naidu sir would know that. So we had booby-trapped, and we were coming out and we were carrying his mobile. So the LTT wanted to make sure that we don't take away his mobile, because when Newton will come back, he was a very famous leader of LTT in the southern area of Sri Lanka. So he would, be very unhappy with their cadre that why did they allow you to take my MAT? You know MAT, that there's a bike.
Colonel, you're fading.
Sunil, your voice is gone. can you just may I request you to just shorten this thing? We are already over short time, please.
So many organizations which things have popped up, so that's the political side of it. No comments. So the IEP use can be combined with so many other things, which now the Dattawadi, that area, Gadricholi, and the Odisha belt, the red belt, all of them try to copy that. Some of them even have instructors from retired LTT cadres in India. They train them.
Right.
So it's a very live threat. And because it's called improvised, you can have any type of improvisation. So the question somebody asked was, how can we, you know, prevent it? So in Kashmir, the only thing we do is we send out road opening party before the traffic comes on the road. And we have a particular trip in which we know what are the types of improvisations, known improvisations till date they can do, and which is what we didn't know, that they can, you know, come with a car and do the Pulwama. And that was the first experience.
Right.
That the ROP was done, the road was absolutely sanitized, but still we lost so many men. So this is how we keep learning lessons. That's what I wanted to share this.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sunil. Very kind of you. Let me salute you. You are a war-wounded soldier. You know, you did great service to the nation. And we salute you. We salute you, Sunil. Thank you for sharing your experience.
And Colonel, we would also like to take this opportunity to thank you for a very insightful and informative session. And we would also like to thank our audience for their participation by way of questions and the comments that have been posted. The details for the next session are listed on the screen, which is Thursday, the 20th of August, 2020. And as the Colonel said, it's on border and coastal security for a new architecture. So thank you once again, Colonel Naidu, and look forward to seeing you on the next one.
Okay, I'd like to thank Ashwin, Hardik, Leela, for your support. Thank you very much. Appreciate your support and help. Thank you. And thank you all for your patience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Colonel Naidu. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much.